Hello and welcome back to Level Up Rugby. Visualisation can be split up and categorised into two specific but interconnected parts: physical preparation and mental preparation, both of which are pretty self-explanatory. Physical prep regarding how you get your body and equipment into the prime position and condition to kick, and mental prep regarding how you get your mind into the optimal state to kick. But as we always do here at Level Up Rugby, we are going to take things a little bit deeper in an attempt to stimulate some thought and debate, getting right into the micro details of how you can maximize the efficiency and effectiveness of the visualization aspect of your process to aid you on your journey in leveling up your knowledge, ability, and performance. How you physically prepare yourself for a kick can be further reduced down into two subcategories. The very first thing we should be looking to do as soon as a try has been scored or a kickable penalty has been awarded is calming our body down and getting ourselves into the best physical state to execute our process. As I'm sure you are well aware, the game of rugby is incredibly fast-paced and physically demanding. So the aim of this first step of our physical preparation is to take ourselves out of that tense state in the high intensity environment and into our own peaceful place of tranquility and calm. First physically, to then allow us to mentally later on. The very best way to begin this process of calming is with your breathing. Being consciously aware of the pace and depth of your breaths, and then using different techniques to help slow it, can directly aid in the lowering of your heart rate, which is the primary cause of your physical tension. Slowly and deeply inhaling, holding, and then slowly exhaling is one method to regain control of your breathing, lowering your heart rate, and in turn, relieving you of your physical tension, allowing you to return to your peaceful place of calm. Being physically calm also interconnects with and actually enables access to a mental state of calm too, as it is very difficult to maintain a calm temperament whilst physically agitated. The importance of which, however, we will be following on to in mental prep after the second stage of physical preparation that I like to call practical prep. After controlling your breathing in an attempt to lower your heart rate, calming yourself down from the frantic pace of the game, enabling entrance to your peaceful place and access to the mental benefits that come along with it, that we will be getting into when we specifically look at mental preparation following this section. The next stage of your physical preparation involves certain practical tricks, tasks, and triggers that you can perform to further prime yourself and your equipment physically for the kick. So, coming up is a collation and a collection of the most common practical preparatory tasks that you will see from the majority of goal kickers in the modern game. Once at the back of your approach, in your start spot, somewhat forcefully tapping the end of your toe into the ground moves your foot forwards inside of the boot to the front of the toe box, filling the shoe in the area that you are looking to contact the ball with, removing any undesired space and preventing any unwanted disconnection between the solid force of your foot and the ball, giving your strike a stronger impact on contact that we know is crucially important in helping us to achieve a larger indent into the ball, and thus the platform and opportunity for a sweeter strike. Owen Farrell is the main practitioner of the next physical practical preparation task, the shorts pull-up. You can perform this by either simply pulling the shorts up, or for those more advanced goal kickers, folding over the club crest or brand badge, whichever is situated on your kicking leg, so that it is facing your leg on the inside of the short, if that makes sense. The main and realistically only minor benefit of this physical equipment preparation is that your short will no longer restrict you from reaching full extension at the hip in your swing, similar to when attempting to reach full depth in a squat. But to be honest, this only really has any particular significance or any apparent benefit if your shorts fit rather long or rather tight. With a similar intention as the shorts pull-up trick, the next physical practical preparation task that you can undertake is the hamstring stretch. This is really just an additional coincidental benefit to be had from checking the alignment of your ball and it seems in relation to the posts. When behind the ball, whilst ensuring that it is positioned in your desired manner, as you check the ball, do so by simply bending at the hips, which will simultaneously give you a good stretch in your hamstrings, loosening them off. Your intent is on achieving essentially the same benefit as the shorts pull-up trick. The only difference is that this time, rather than preparing your equipment to prevent it from restricting your full range of movement, you are instead preparing your body to allow you to more easily and comfortably reach full extension around the hip in your follow-through that we know and will come onto when we look at our swing as being integral in achieving a greater foot speed and thus power and thus distance on your goal kick. Finally, we have the practice rep. This is a physical preparation task that has grown in popularity over the past few years, but again, I personally seem to remember Owen Farrell as being its main pioneering practitioner that inspired its rapid mass replication. At least for me, I don't know about you. Leave your comment down below to whoever you copied to start doing this. As the same with all of these little tricks, it is incredibly straightforward to perform. In this practical preparation, you are simply trying to perfectly recreate the portion of your swing preceding your strike and the posture you want to hold yourself in at the point of contact with the ball. This may entail you bracing your core whilst simultaneously practicing the ideal swing of your balance arm and your kicking leg for a couple of reps. Maybe also brushing your kicking foot along the grass to provide some extra over-exaggerated but minor resistance, further priming you physically. Or any other cues that you have that really embodies the key elements of your swing and strike. Of course, doing this will somewhat physically prepare you, as we have mentioned, loosening you off before your kick, just the same as the other tricks. However, beyond that initial physical preparatory benefit, the primary objective of recreating your ideal posture whilst stationary and under no pressure is to physically familiarize yourself with the shape that you want to return to once at the ball. So therefore, also interconnected with and additionally indirectly benefiting you mentally too, by priming you in order to aid you in more easily refinding that same perfect posture whilst under the pressure of timing and when it counts for the most. And that can be said for all of these physical preparation tasks on a macro scale too, as we will come on to.
Coming up is a short but encompassing list of alternative additional physical preparation tasks that's purpose leans somewhat more on the side of principle reasoning rather than practical application, the importance of which we will be coming on to shortly. This has got to be the most iconic practical prep task of all time, of course being made famous by Johnny Wilkinson. However, although continuing to grow in popularity, being adopted by many a goal kicker, I continue to question its true purpose. What functionality does this hand-holding actually have? What practical preparatory purpose does it serve? Now, I'm no physician, but I don't believe that the calves, both collectively or even singular, individually, are used in goal kicking to the point of requiring a specific practical preparation task. If you're really looking to unnecessarily warm up and more likely fatigue a more appropriate muscle group before a kick, you may as well do some squats or lunges for your quads instead, as they are used far more comparatively when goal kicking. And thus, this is yet another physical preparation task performed purely on principle, without any significant practical purpose. I understand how this physical preparation task can be seen by many to have practical functionality. However, if you truly believe that this cluster of grass being thrown at head height is giving you a measurement of the wind at post height, where you are actually about to send the ball in another 30 seconds time, any more accurately than you already know from the pre-game weather report or the in-game experience and feeling of the conditions, then you really need to reassess your rationale and how superstitious you think you are not. Now, you may say, and actually have a case, that just like the grass throw, this physical preparation task does have some practical value. And if you were to say that, I wouldn't disagree. However, with the innovative improvements in the fields of both boot technology, for example, with Nike's, I must say, highly effective anti-clog sole plate, and pitch quality, I, for one, have never really found any considerably noticeable plant foot slippage problems anymore. And if my plant does slip, it's not usually as a result of the mud clogging my boot, but more so to do with the pitch already being too soggy as it is. Which is unavoidable, the only fix being a slower approach with a less aggressive plant, as we will eventually come on to in phase 4 when discussing conditions. Our final, unnecessary, principally, as opposed to practically based physical preparation task is whatever the f*** you call this from Rob Cook.
How would you describe that?
Constipated.
Thanks, Austin.
But effective.
I'm a firm believer in the importance of these physical preparatory tricks remaining practical and not becoming riddled with superstition, causing them to be performed purely on principle. Just because you watched your favourite kicker do them on telly, or because you always have done them. I always challenge kickers and press them on why they do certain ritualistic practices as a part of their visualization process, to which they usually struggle to come up with a rational, logical, practical answer other than it's just what I do. I encourage you to check yourself and assure that you do not unnecessarily overcomplicate your process by basing these practical preparation tasks on principle. Ensure that anything and everything you do is purposeful, has practical application and functional reasoning behind it. If not, then you are becoming overly superstitious and are mentally losing control of your kick, leaving it in the hands and feet of whatever superstitious fortune god that you serve. However, that being said, I do believe that there are indirect benefits of these preparatory physical tasks beyond their initial practical value. And that interconnects us and leads us nicely onto the second stage of our visualization process, our mental preparation. Following on from our physical preparation, after priming your body and equipment by physically calming yourself down and employing some practical preparatory tasks, now we want to build on this calm and prepared physiological base by mentally preparing ourselves to take the kick at goal. There are two key states that we want to mentally transition ourselves into before taking the kick. The first of which we have already hinted at and highlighted as being interconnected with our physical preparation. Linking back to what we previously spoke about with regard to maintaining practical reasoning behind each and every one of your physical preparation tasks, and also calming your body by lowering your heart rate with breathing in order to access and enter your peaceful place, I finally finished by suggesting that there may potentially be some additional indirect mental benefit interconnected with your physical preparatory tasks beyond their initial physical practical face value, as previously discussed. That benefit potentially gives reason and value to integrating certain aspects into your visualization process based on principle rather than strictly practical. As I mentioned, on a micro scale, performing practice reps primes your body in the sense that you become familiarized with the ideal position and posture that you want to return to at the point of contact with the ball, whilst static, aiding you in more easily refinding that same position when under the pressure of timing, as you are actually taking the kick. However, we can also apply this very same logic on a macro scale to every action that we perform as a part of our visualization preparation, and actually every aspect of our process as a whole too. You see, in the same way that your body becomes familiar with the position it wants to return to upon strike, if you remain consistent with your process and continuously repeat it accurately, ingraining it into your muscle memory, including all of the principle-based superstitious rituals you perform, your body and mind also become familiar with that process as a whole too, on a macro scale. Now, the benefit of this is that as you repeat your full process, whatever it may be, whether it's throwing grass in the air and then awkwardly doing the Macarena like Dan Bigger, or setting your arms to the side like Quade Cooper, or holding your hands together like Johnny Wilkinson, or whatever Ronaldo impersonation Rob Cook used to do, you trigger the same familiarity response that enters you into a muscle memory induced state of semi-unconsciousness. First of all, let's define what is actually meant by semi-unconsciousness. Unconscious in the sense that you are limiting and ideally eradicating all thought from your mind, almost primitively in complete mindless, muscle memory induced and guided process acceptance, focusing broadly on accurately repeating the process that you have ingrained into your muscle memory through countless repetitions, rather than specifically on any individual aspect of it, without any particularly significant thought for specific micro details, as you are guided more so by a feeling rather than conscious thought, trusting in your muscle memory to guide the way, with the ball merely somewhat just getting in the way of your swing, rather than consciously trying to strike each individual kick. Semi, because in line with the 80-20 principle, with the belief that 80% of the outcomes come from 20% of the causes, as previously discussed in other videos, you may choose to have just one or two key cues or macro integral points of focus in your form that you know if you get right, you will have a higher probability of a successful outcome. Again, in line with the 80-20 principle that we'll be taking a deeper look at in further detail in phase four. And also, if these mental cues remain consistent in every kick too, just the same as your principally or practically based physical tasks, they will also trigger that exact same familiarity response, further inducing your state of semi-unconsciousness. Real life professional examples of this include Dan Carter's head down, follow through mantra, or Rugby Bricks' stay slow, trust my timing cue. Or with me, it centered around the angle of my plant and the direction of my swing, as we'll come onto again in another video. As I began discussing in the preliminary introductory walkback video, ideally, every kick should be treated exactly the same, like a long goal kick as opposed to a pass in football. Because with this mechanistic mentality, as opposed to an artistic perspective, you are far more likely to achieve a consistent result with a consistent process, treating every ball identically rather than individually. Now, believe it or not, in the long run, after ingraining your process and ideal kicking form into your unconscious muscle memory through countless process-focused repetitions in training, as we'll come on to, when performing, it is far easier to accurately repeat your process consistently without actually thinking about it. If we are overly conscious, thinking about each and every individual micro detail of our intricately elaborate process, this would be incredibly and realistically impossibly overwhelming, especially with the level of detail that we go into here at Level Up Rugby, most likely proving detrimental to our performance and success, as this high level of detailed consciousness is more likely to overwhelm and distract us than aid us in any way. However, if we can calm ourselves, removing all thoughts from our mind in complete unconscious acceptance of the process that we have ingrained into our muscle memory over the course of time and countless repetitions, triggered by physical tasks and mental cues, then we can treat every kick, no matter the angle or the distance, exactly the same, with a consistent process leading to a consistent result. A great analogy to further explain the concept of a semi-unconscious state at work is the difference between speaking your native language and a new foreign language. For anyone who has previously been or are currently in the process of learning a new language, whether you are actually aware of it or not before watching this video, when speaking in your native tongue, to an extent, your thought is more consciously concerned with and centered around the message attempting to be conveyed, as opposed to strictly the specific individual words being selected. When you are simply speaking normally, you aren't really consciously thinking about what specific words you are saying, which can often lead to misinterpretation. but are just more so thinking broadly about the message you are trying to get across. However, when speaking a foreign language that you aren't too familiar with, you not only have to think broadly about what message you are trying to convey, but how exactly you are going to say it too. What specific words mean, their pronunciation, their order, etc. This is an analogy for how your unconscious mind works, because when speaking a language that you are familiar with, you can ignore the specific details of the process, how to speak, and think solely about the outcome, what you are trying to say. Of course, taken too far, as all goal kickers are aware, with solitary thought for only the outcome, and you lose control of the process, clarity of speech, or your kicking form. So that's not what I'm promoting. What I am proposing, however, is to relax and lose thought for anything, allowing your muscle memory to take over and guide the way, just as you do when you're talking. This same analogy can be similarly applied to another aspect of rugby, when passing the ball in a game. At least for me as a 10, after having practiced countless repetitions of passes, consciously ingraining my ideal form into my unconscious muscle memory, when performing in game, my thoughts are not so much regarding the specific, intricate details of executing my pass, maybe one or two key cues, but more so on who I am passing to, why I am passing to them, what I intend to happen as a result of that action in relation to the micro tactic for that individual passage of play within the broader macro strategic context of the game, and what I or my teammates maybe need to do next. As a result, I am somewhat forced into an unconscious state, as I have no time or space to think about the process of my pass, as I am preoccupied with so many other thoughts, yet I still pass the ball just as well, if not consistently even better. The crux of it though, of course, again, is that too much focus on the outcome, as we all know, can distract you from completing your process accurately, which is especially the case when goal kicking, as we discussed in process focus in nets. And the difficulty in the difference between passing and goal kicking that accentuates the negative is that you are blessed, or actually more appropriately cursed, with a lot more time and a much more intricately detailed process when goal kicking. As proceedings relatively slow down preceding the kick, we are given all of this additional time to think, and that extra consciousness and thought, be it about the outcome or even about the details of your process, can often distract you from your semi-unconscious state of process acceptance, taking away the aforementioned benefits that come along with it, and thus turning thinking into overthinking by definition, as it begins to impede your performance, as you become overwhelmed with thought. So, when given all of this time to goal kick, I'm not saying to distract yourself out of your unconscious state by overthinking solely about the outcome, as you might do to an extent when time is limited whilst passing during a game or when speaking your native language. But more importantly, nor am I saying to distract yourself out of your unconscious state by overthinking intricately about the details of your process either. When performing, what I actually suggest, believe it or not, is less thought altogether. I promote a lack of thought about, of course, the outcome, but also to an extent about your process too. I believe that you'll perform your process more consistently by trusting in and making use of the countless hours spent and repetitions practiced kicking into a net, building, molding, mastering, and ingraining your ideal process and kicking form into your unconscious, allowing your muscle memory, along with a couple of key cues, to take the reins and consistently lead you to a consistent outcome, rather than consciously thinking about each and every detail of both the outcome and the process, trying to consciously control it. A final example of an unconscious state at work is a practice called method acting. This is where actors fully submerge and engross themselves into the character that they are attempting to portray. When performing the role, rather than consciously thinking about what the character may say or do at every turn, they instead become that character. They research and understand every nuance, and then slowly, consciously ingrain and internalize those details, submerging themselves into the role so that they somewhat become the character. So that no matter what they are faced with in any scene, they are naturally the person they are trying to portray, without the delay or hesitation of any thought.
In Batman Begins, and so I knew there was an opportunity for a new version of the Joker, and that excited me, and I also knew instantly what to do.
So we had about a month, roughly 2 months, he had already started to occupy the character.
I locked myself away for 6 weeks in a room, and I kind of came up with this creep. Walk around like a madman in finding posture, finding stance. Finding his voice is very important, because when you find the voice, you find the breath within the voice.
Goal kicking should be like method acting. After educating yourself on your process and ingraining it into your muscle, memory, and unconscious mind, essentially who you are during training, rather than thinking about what you are attempting to do at each and every stage whilst performing, you instead trust in your aforementioned preparation and go out to perform by just being your new self, without having to think about what you should do at each and every stage in complete mindless, muscle memory guided process acceptance, treating every kick identically rather than individually. And this idea can be applied to not only other facets of rugby, like we said with passing, but also, more broadly speaking, to life as a whole too. For this theory of a semi-unconscious state to work, however, we must first manufacture, mold, and master our ideal process, and then, most importantly, ingrain it into our muscle memory. But how exactly do we do that? Well, this is a great demonstration of where the concluding section of the Level Up Rugby mission statement comes from, whilst also highlighting the difference between kicking in training and performing in matches. As the same with any habit, to proactively ingrain a chosen action into our behavior to the point of obliviousness when performing it, enabling it to be performed semi-unconsciously, we must first consciously be aware of what exactly it is we are trying to achieve and acquire muscle memory of. In goal kicking, this simply means knowing and understanding each specific micro detail of your individual ideal process, inside and out, which is the value that we provide here for free at Level Up Rugby through thought stimulating discussion and debate, informing and developing your knowledge and understanding of goal kicking and other areas of rugby. Then in training, understanding and utilizing this knowledge, of course linking back to what we learnt in the episode on kicking into nets, we want to ensure perfect practice of our ideal process, focusing on ingraining one specific individual element at a time into our unconscious muscle memory before moving on to the next, as to not become overwhelmed trying to consciously think about and control each and every micro detail at once when taking a kick, as we spoke about earlier. This may entail a whole session focusing your attention solely on the pull of your balance arm, or the depth, width, and angle of your plant foot, or your swing, or your final step, or your strike, etc., etc., any aspect that we will cover in phase three, being sure to ingrain it perfectly into your muscle memory so that it simply becomes natural. This is the difference between knowledge and ability. We first understood what we were trying to achieve and acquire unconscious muscle memory of, meaning that through the application of that knowledge, we are now able to act out our ideal process and achieve our desired outcome. Finally, after knowledge and ability comes performance, which is what we've been talking about so far throughout this mental preparation discussion. As we have covered, when it comes to performing in games, we don't want to be overthinking about each and every individual detail and variable of our process, like we did one section at a time whilst consciously ingraining specific aspects in training. To compute that level of detailed information in the split second period of time we have whilst kicking would be impossible. Instead, we want to make use of and trust in all the countless conscious, compartmentalized, perfect, detail-driven repetitions practiced in all the hours spent process-focused kicking into nets in training that have ingrained our ideal process into our muscle memory, and confidently, in complete process trust and acceptance, enter our state of semi-unconsciousness with the help of a few key cues, and guided by our muscle memory, perform our ideal process without the distraction of any thought about the outcome or even any thought about micro details of the process. I understand people when they say that I overthink or overcomplicate goal kicking, because I too once thought the same about other kickers. So I can completely see where they are coming from. But over the course of time, as I began to educate myself, I learnt that in all walks of life, not just rugby, just because someone is unwilling or unable to see the detail, it doesn't mean that it doesn't exist, and it doesn't mean that it cannot help. It's like viewing a piece of art. Professionals will tell you this, that, and the other about what it symbolizes and the artist's intentions behind the piece, and pick out bits of detail you question even exist. But just because you cannot or do not want to admit to seeing those details, it does not mean that they are not there. The uneducated eye is simply blind to them, or too proud to admit blindness, and is thus rejecting of them. However, saying this, like I have said to begin with, I do see where people are coming from and how, when performing, not physically overcomplicating or mentally overthinking your process by keeping it simple and reducing it down to a minimum of a few key cues, is beneficial and the right thing to do. By definition, the use of the adverb over with regard to complicating and thinking implies too much, which by definition means that it's of an amount that is detrimental to your well-being or success, in this case, performance. So when performing in game, if you're thinking about the details of your process to the point that it overwhelms you and negatively affects the outcome of your kick, then you are overthinking. But crucially, don't forget that the limitations of your thoughts that turns thinking into detrimental overthinking may be different to the limitations of others, meaning that they can think to more depth and breadth before it becomes detrimental to their well-being and success. And thus, overthinking, by definition to you, is just thinking to them. As I mentioned in previous episodes on visualization and walk back, if you want to be the world's best goal kicker, you're not going to get there by treating each kick individually, striking each ball differently. You're going to need to think and work smart first by educating yourself, acquiring knowledge, and fundamentally understanding the process that you have created. And then you'll need to work hard to ingrain each and every individual micro detail into your muscle memory. But after working smart, understanding, manufacturing, molding, mastering the details, and then most importantly, working hard, ingraining those details into your natural muscle memory in training, to think about specific details of your process when performing in game to the point of it being overwhelming, which is easily done in the amount of time you're given to take the kick at goal, by definition, is overthinking, as it often proves to be detrimental to your success. In most cases then, when training, thought is required when working smart to give you the knowledge of what needs ingraining. But once the preliminary smart and hard work has been put in, when performing, any thought that takes you out of a semi-unconscious state by definition will be overthinking, and thus should be avoided, instead favoring complete mindless, unconscious process acceptance, as you are guided by the feeling of your muscle memory as opposed to conscious thought. Shadow kicking is a great drill that is even more form focused than kicking into nets, as the outcome is not the only thing being removed, it's the ball as well. You're not focusing on kicking that individual ball, you're focusing on completing your ideal process identically to how you always do. There's two applications of this drill. First of all, there's the ingraining of your ideal form into your unconscious muscle memory, which starts with educating yourself on what your ideal form actually looks like, so that you know and understand when you're doing things right or when you're doing things wrong when you review your footage. Then there's the application of that knowledge to ingrain your ideal form into your unconscious muscle memory one step at a time, focusing an entire session on the angle of your approach or the pace of your approach or the length of your final step or the angle or the depth or the width of your plant foot or the trajectory of your swing, etc., etc. A whole session focusing on ingraining that specific detail without a distraction of a ball, simply form focused. Then the second application of this drill is completing your entire process and practicing the transition into a semi-unconscious state. You're going to go through the entirety of your process from start to end, completely form focused, without the distraction of the outcome or even the distraction of the ball. You're going to practice each and every step to internalize those details. And then you're going to practice just transitioning into your unconscious state, allowing your body to lead the way through muscle memory rather than conscious thought, like we always say, so that you're treating that kick identically to how you always do rather than kicking that specific individual ball. Then finally, you can reintroduce the ball if you like and see how closely you stick to your ideal form. Does the ball distract you, or do you still complete your process perfectly? Are you kicking that individual ball, or are you just simply completing your ideal process identically to how you always do, with the ball merely just getting in the way? That's shadow kicking. Get out there and just practice your process without the distraction of the outcome or even the ball itself. Just completely form focused and see how far you get to ingraining your ideal form into your unconscious muscle memory. Now that we understand what a semi-unconscious state is, why you want to utilize it and the benefits of doing so, and also how you develop it, the final question that must be asked and answered is how you go about achieving it, which ties in very closely with what we discussed in physical preparation. If you've ever tried meditation, then I'm sure at some point you will have encountered the challenge of clearing your mind of thought. And achieving a semi-unconscious state of thoughtlessness is a very similar process. It's not something that can be easily turned on and off, especially when performing a detailed task and over the course of a long period of time that you are given to take a kick at goal, whilst also under considerable external pressures, as we'll come on to when talking about flow state. The best way to start this process of entering a state of semi-unconsciousness is similar to meditation, to focus on your breathing. This focus not only calms your physical state, as we mentioned in the physical preparation parts of this episode on visualization, which allows entrance into your mental peaceful place
as we discussed, but it also takes your thoughts away from any other distractions too, be it about the outcome or even the process itself. Additionally, as also previously mentioned, you may choose to have a few macro integral points of focus in your kicking form that you know if you get right, you will have a much higher probability of completing your process accurately and achieving a successful outcome. However, not only will these broad form-centered focal points bring the benefit of security to your process, but they too will also contribute to your indoctrination into your semi-unconscious state when consistently repeated into your muscle memory, just the same as any physical cues and triggers. But take note that we are not advocating the thought of any intricate details, as these will easily distract you from your unconscious state, as we know, but are more so just talking about a mantra to follow and kick by. Beyond that, it should simply be business as usual. Go on to follow the specific order of your process, completing each and every stage perfectly and identically to how you always do. Every practically and even principally based physical and mental preparation task, and let go of trying to consciously control the kick, as your muscle memory grows with each of these physical and mental cues triggering the same familiarity response, continuing on into the kick itself to the point that your body is now being guided by a feeling of familiarity. Be careful, however, of overcomplicating your process with too many stages, principally or even practically based, as the more tasks you add, the longer your process becomes and the easier it is to forget certain steps along the way and thus consequently lose habitual muscle memory. So be sure to still maintain and uphold the standard of minimizing the inclusion of principally based physical preparation tasks, as their value is limited beyond the indoctrination into your state of semi-unconsciousness, and eventually has the opposite effect of destroying your muscle memory if too many are added, as they become difficult to keep track of. It is therefore best to keep things simple and limit yourself to a minimum of strictly what you require to practically prepare yourself for the kick, rather than having too many of these principally based tasks that are less and less effective the more of them you add. Most important of all, however, is repetition. The more you practice your process perfectly, the further indoctrinated it becomes into your muscle memory, just like any other action, skill, or behavior in life. When the time comes to be self-aware and conscious of your actions in training, whilst ingraining specific details of individual elements individually, be sure to work as close to perfection as possible, to be sure that you're internalizing your ideal form, as we discussed in NETS. However, when the time comes to switch off your consciousness, relax, enter your peaceful place, and trust in and commit to all the smart and hard work that you have put in to take control of the process and lead you to a successful outcome. Another beneficial state you should be looking to achieve whilst taking a kick at goal, but will often naturally find yourself in game anyway, is a state of flow. It is similar to a semi-unconscious state, but not entirely the same. As you'll see, they both usually occur simultaneously and are somewhat codependent with a mutual causality, but they themselves are independent concepts. A flow state is more about the frame of mind beyond simply total physical and mental relaxation that we've covered so far, that best allows your unconscious muscle memory to take over and perform. It has been described as being the fluidity between body and mind, as you are totally absorbed by and deeply focused on the task, beyond the point of distraction. Be it the internal distraction of mental chatter when decision-making, as your attempt to consciously control proceedings is replaced by instinctive play, where decisions are causally made unconsciously, based off of internalized experience. Or be it the external distraction of the crowd cheering or booing,
or the imminent danger of the opposition approaching in an attempt to charge down your kick, or your personal life outside of the game, or even the passing of time itself. As many exclaim, although time appears to slow down whilst engaged in the present moment, once out and beyond, it seems to have flown by, and you may even lose recollection of certain events even happening, if in a deep state of flow whilst performing the task. One example where I'm sure you will have experienced this is when reading a book, as if you're not completely focused on the task, free from the internal distraction, a thought about anything other than the words on the page in front of you, or the external distraction of background noise, for example, then you'll find yourself rereading pages. But when you are focused, fully engrossed by and absorbed in the book, you'll perform a lot better with no need to reread any sentence, paragraph, or page, as you are void of any distraction, with time relatively appearing to pass hypnotically quickly. Alternatively, a lot of extreme sports people and professional athletes are forced into a flow state, resulting in semi-unconscious muscle memory-orientated behavior, similar to the passing example we previously discussed, as they partake in a high-risk, high-skill-level task that requires complete concentration, because without it, they either fall to their death or lose the Rugby World Cup. Both relatively risky activities. Like I mentioned at the start of this video and before with the passing example of a semi-unconscious state at work, these athletes, and most likely you too, will find yourself in a flow state without even noticing it. So don't worry too much about forcing it, as it will most likely be forced on you, all until the unconscious spell is broken by the conscious distraction of the recognition of your being in the state, having now watched this video. So I'm sorry about that. Ignorance truly is bliss. However, now aware, I'm sure you can think back to a time, most likely in a game, where you have felt such a way. And hopefully, now understanding what that feeling was, you have the tools to go about best replicating it and reaping the reward of its benefits with regard to unconscious muscle memory guided performance. Now we have covered physical preparation and the psychological side of mental preparation, it's time to move on to the second half of mental prep and conclude with the specific visualization process itself, which can be broken down into three segments. Before anything, you must first know where you are targeting to kick the ball. Although a seemingly obvious answer for some and in some conditions, how you answer this question for each individual kick can be influenced by two variables, ball flight and wind. At Level Up Rugby, we promote a straight ball flight, above all else because it's an indication of our definition of a sweet strike. Where not only are you kicking the ball, but the ball is also kicking itself off of your foot, back along the optimal line through one of the axes of the ball, preferably the vertical axis, for reasons explained in the videos on tee selection and ball setup. However, we can also sympathize that our definition of an optimal swing that we'll be covering in later videos, which benefits contradictorily outweigh a sweet strike to a certain extent, can lead to a slightly drawn ball flight. In this case, you're going to want to visually target slightly off center, depending on your preferred foot, so that the ball eventually concludes its flight at the center of the posts. But this does, of course, depend on your distance from the posts, which does add unnecessary complexity. The further away the ball starts its flight, the more opportunity it has to draw around. So when positioned directly in front, around 22 meters out, you're gonna want to target straight down the middle because the ball won't have any time to draw around at all. But the further back you go, the further to the side you're going to want to target to a certain extent, because the ball now has more opportunity to draw around before it concludes its flight at the center of the target when it crosses the posts, which becomes even more complex and difficult when narrowing the angle that you're kicking from the sideline. That being said, a swing that results in a draw so large that you're initially aiming outside of the posts is never going to outweigh the benefits of a sweet strike. So therefore, whether you're looking to draw the ball around or hit it straight, the answer is to always be targeting inside of the posts. Now we have covered physical preparation and the psychological side of mental preparation, it's time to move on to the second half of mental prep and conclude with the specific visualization process itself, which can be broken down into three segments. Before anything, you must first know where you are targeting to kick the ball. Although a seemingly obvious answer for some and in some conditions, how you answer this question for each individual kick can be influenced by two variables: ball flight and wind. At Level Up Rugby, we promote a straight ball flight above all else because it's an indication of our definition of a sweet strike. Where not only are you kicking the ball, but the ball is also kicking itself off of your foot, back along the optimal line through one of the axes of the ball, preferably the vertical axis, for reasons explained in the videos on tee selection and ball setup. However, we can also sympathize that our definition of an optimal swing that we'll be covering in later videos, which benefits contradictorily outweigh a sweet strike to a certain extent, can lead to a slightly drawn ball flight. In this case, you're going to want to visually target slightly off center, depending on your preferred foot, so that the ball eventually concludes its flight at the center of the posts. But this does, of course, depend on your distance from the posts, which does add unnecessary complexity. The further away the ball starts its flight, the more opportunity it has to draw around. So when positioned directly in front, around 22 meters out, you're gonna want to target straight down the middle because the ball won't have any time to draw around at all. But the further back you go, the further to the side you're going to want to target to a certain extent, because the ball now has more opportunity to draw around before it concludes its flight at the center of the target when it crosses the posts, which becomes even more complex and difficult when narrowing the angle that you're kicking from the sideline. That being said, a swing that results in a draw so large that you're initially aiming outside of the posts is never going to outweigh the benefits of a sweet strike. So therefore, whether you're looking to draw the ball around or hit it straight, the answer is to always be targeting inside of the posts. This same rule also applies when considering the weather conditions too. Although an uncontrollable variable, it is still important to account for the wind when goal kicking. The wind can cause the ball to draw or fade outside of your control, which is the only instance you ever want to consider a fading ball flight off the tee. Therefore, including this variable in your initial targeting process is an important step in achieving a successful outcome. Similarly to the consideration of your ball flight, the wind conditions only become significant enough for you to adjust your target the further away from the posts you get. This is because realistically, with an average kick, the ball will travel 20 meters in your desired direction before either its trajectory increases to an altitude where its flight is increasingly susceptible to external influence, or its speed slows enough to be blown off course. And you can, of course, increase this distance by manipulating your ball setup or your swing, but more on that when we specifically discuss conditions in phase four on uncontrollable variables. So the same as when adjusting your target for your drawing ball flight, the wind will rarely be extreme enough for you to be targeting outside of the width of the posts. And you'd be wise not to, because if the wind dies down just as you kick the ball, even slightly, or if you strike the ball even slightly sweeter or harder or lower than anticipated, which is incredibly likely, then you'll want to be targeting somewhere between the posts. We'll be covering ball flight and conditions separately in more detail in later videos. But the basic principle for targeting is, if not down the middle of the post for whatever reason, then at least always target inside of the post. After picking your target between the posts, the next stage of the visualization process is what people typically associate with visualization as a whole, your method of aiming. Beyond seeing the realistic location of your target between the posts, depending on the distance and angle of your kick, aiming is the process of seeing how the ball is going to get to that spot, typically with the help of visual tools. These tools are a very personal element of goal kicking, as they are also incredibly interconnected with entering your aforementioned semi-unconscious state. But whether principally based on superstitious reasoning or practically based for preparatory reasoning, the creation and development of these tools, as we will see, often starts early on in a goal kicker's journey as they learn from and imitate other kickers. Because of this, tools can differ vastly between players, to the extent that they even almost form personal brands. However, there are a few basic trends which have become common rugby knowledge that we're going to list off for inspiration. One of the original and simplest visual aiming tools, which originated from sniper marksmen, is the mantra of aim small, miss small. This is the idea where you aim for a smaller target within your larger target to really specify the location you're aiming for, narrowing your scope so that even if you slightly miss your smaller target, you'll still easily be within the circumference of your original target. The rugby application of this is picking a specific spot beyond the target to aim for, rather than the general vicinity of the post. This could be a spectator in the crowd, a branch of a tree, or a letter on a piece of advertising. But try to avoid using moving targets such as clouds for obvious reasons. This tool can also be applied to specify your target on the ball that you're aiming to strike. Rather than looking to generally kick the ball, you can dial in on a letter on a sponsor, a blemish on the ball, or a group of pimples on its surface, the place that will optimize the most pushback from the ball. An additional benefit of picking a specific spot that is also beyond the original target is that it will encourage you to get through the ball. However, the difficulty that I find with this is that it leads to you preparing to overhit the ball as hard as you can in every kick to get the ball to this unrealistic target, even when the additional swing speed for further distances isn't required. One may argue that by doing this, you're truly kicking the ball the same way every time, no matter the distance, but there are dangers and drawbacks of swinging faster that we'll be covering, along with the benefits of swinging smoother in later videos when we directly look at our swing. Instead then, I developed this rugby application of the aim small, miss small visual tool from a specific target in the distance beyond the posts to my dad, who would always be stood behind the middle of the crossbar. This similarly acts as a more specific target than just between the posts, but also generally aided me judge the depth and weight of the kick, allowing me to adjust my swing speed within my form accordingly. This indicated when I could stay relaxed and swing smoother for kicks within my natural range when extra swing speed for further distances wasn't required, meaning that I could avoid the dangers of added swing speed and access the benefits of a smoother swing, all of which will be covered later. Not only this, but seeing where I actually needed the ball to land rather than a spot far in the distance allowed me to better account for my naturally drawn ball flight, as I could see where the ball actually needed to conclude its flight rather than having to calculate at what point in its flight it needed to be at the center of the posts. My kick the ball to dad visual guide is just my own small adaptation of the aim small, miss small tool that works for me. It may not necessarily be right for you, but hopefully demonstrates how you can adapt these basic tools to suit yourself and the way that you think. Another adaptation of this visual aiming tool utilizes more imagination than sight. Personally, I remember Lee Halfpenny explaining this tool in a skills video I watched growing up. When aiming a shot at goal, he imagines a third post in between the two posts that he is trying to hit to specify his target. He then goes on to talk about how doing this takes him back to his grassroots rugby club, transferring him to a place of peace, that allows him to perform semi-unconsciously and access all the countless repetitions he has practiced that ingrained his form into his muscle memory. And you can do the same by taking this tool and practicing it kicking side on against the post rather than always from out in front. This will practically teach you to specify your target and truly test the accuracy of your form. Because if you can hit the smaller target of the post consistently, all you then need to do is imagine that post in your visualization process and hit it again. Just be sure in practice that you perform the drill by sticking to your form and adjusting it rather than playing the game and compromising it to hit the post. Another classic, now common knowledge aiming tool that anyone watching rugby during the 2015 World Cup cycle has most likely seen is the draw the line method. I'm starting to wonder whether it's just my generation in the UK that had taken a lot of inspiration from Owen Farrell, or if his kicking style really was that unique. But if you're a rugby fan and don't remember the Owen Farrell eyes, then you must have been living under a rock between 2012 and 2015. This is another imagery-based aiming tool as opposed to visual-based, and is also pretty self-explanatory. Once you have decided on your targets, all you're going to do is draw a line from the ball to that spot. And you can keep on doing this back and forth until your heart's content, and you can see your line to the target like a golfer on the putting green or an F1 driver trying to hit the apex. This aiming tool does tie nicely into the final stage of the visualization process, manifestation, that we'll be coming on to, and is useful for imagining where you want the ball to go. But the downside of it is that it takes your focus away from how you're going to get it there. For this reason, there are actually better lines to be drawn that help you aim while still keeping your focus on the process. For example, if you follow the Level Up Rugby setup of a straight ball alignment, then the only line you need to draw, as demonstrated and explained in my One Look Kick at Goal video, is a straight one from point to point through the ball. As if you kick along that line, then you'll send the ball straight in the direction that it's pointing. Alternatively, you could also draw your line of approach and the line of your follow through beyond the ball, as these imaginary lines keep your focus on the process whilst visualizing and aiming. The only real unanimous downside of these aiming tools is that they have the potential to take you out of your semi-unconscious state and disrupt the momentum of your goal kicking process. But this is only the case if you keep changing your process or spend too long on this stage, you become static and stagnant. An example of how this element of the process can vary from person to person, especially in its length, can be seen with the golfer Cameron Smith. He spends no time practicing his putting swing, instead opting to feel the putt based on his years of experience. There are plenty of other aiming tools that we'll be letting the professionals themselves explain. But the truth is that beyond the potential of helping you enter a semi-unconscious state of flow, none of these visual aiming tools will actually make you kick the ball any better. So don't waste too much time on them, especially if the added time taken takes you out of rhythm as you become too conscious with the length of time you have to think. The final stage of the visualization section of mental preparation is manifestation. This element goes beyond any rational preparatory details of your process and starts well before you take the kick. Manifestation focuses on generating a feeling of self-belief before your kick. This is typically done by picturing your desired result in its entirety in a hope that you will go on to recreate it in reality. But the process of building this level of trust and confidence in your process that allows you to relax and let your muscle memory take over starts long before this kick, with preparation in the form of smart and hard work, respectively. Once you have prepared by building your process and ingraining it into your muscle memory, you should rationally be confident. At this point, any feeling of anxiety is irrational, as it is performance impeding, because you'll never perform as well whilst tense. That confidence should then inspire relaxation, as you understand that at this point now, you have done all that you can do, and that the best way to perform your process in this moment is to enter your semi-unconscious state and let the muscle memory that you have worked hard and smart for to take over. Of course, being human means that performing robotically without emotion in the form of anxiety or anything else is difficult. But this is just the foundational theory that we'll be going on and exploring in more detail when looking at our kicking philosophy in later videos.